Okay, let's continue with the next lecture. This lecture is based on the proximity sensors. We have seen some examples of proximity sensors in previous videos. There I covered IR sensor and second was the ultrasonic sensor. We are going to take the discussion to a next level, construction point of view. So if we see what are the basic types of proximity sensors, you will find that there are inductive and capacitive type proximity sensors. Further in the discussion we will see a new topic, that is a limit switch. So you might have seen when some operation is going on, that is without human involvement. So after certain destination is reached, in that case we require that the operation should be break. Like you, for let me give an example, you will be suppose you are using a for loop and if for some kind of criteria has been satisfied and you want to break that loop, so use one instruction, that is a break. In same fashion we will use one switch which will limit the operation, that is called as a limit switch. And in last we will see a touch sensor. No doubt as we have seen earlier, here in this lecture we will see each part Arduino point of view as well. Means at the end of that article I am going to cover the interfacing of that particular sensor with Arduino and what is the code regarding that. I will explain that code in detail. Let's move ahead. We'll start with the very first one, that is a inductive proximity sensor. So proximity sensors, if you see, those are basically classified into these three categories. First is called as a inductive type sensor, second is called as a capacitive type sensor, and third is called as a touch sensor. Here in this figure I have given the various kind of proximity sensor. The mostly that is what we will be using. Suppose in case we decided to use in our lab, then we'll go with this kind of design. And in industry the people go with these are the several type of the proximity sensors. You can find them, you can Google and get the details for that. Further, let's start with our discussion. We'll discuss in basically what is a proximity sensor. So whenever you design a robot and that robot is we want to have that task to be done at its own, you assign some task to that, you assign some program, you write some program for that. So in order to get that task done, the robot is required to find out that object, whether it is present in its vicinity. Vicinity I want to say in the sense that in its neighborhood, in its surroundings place. So our robot will get an action. Suppose there is a conveyor belt and on that conveyor belt you did not place any object and you want that robot should pick up that object and align it on other side in a proper sequence. So what it is going to do that you must have some mechanism so that the object will is present on that conveyor belt or not, it must be sensed properly. So in order to get it that, so we want that the robot should be able to detect the exact location of an object, okay, whenever it comes into the neighborhood. So this requirement gives us to a sensor. That sensor is called as a proximity sensor, which detects an object whenever that object approaches within the detection boundary. So every sensor is going to sense some object or some material when it comes in the range. Okay, so there is some area, as we say that electromagnetic field has some range where it can be, you can experience the electromotive force. Similarly, gravitational force, a planet is there and some asteroid is there, or some another planet is there. So in order to experience that gravitational force, you need to come into the range of that gravitational force. In same fashion, the sensor will be able to detect a particular object whenever the object will comes into its detection boundary. So that detection boundary plays an important role. Today in this lecture I am not going to talk about the requirement of a sensor, that is already basically covered in very first lecture. So here we will see, let's go ahead. So you can say that a proximity sensor is mostly used to detect an object. So we can call it like a object detector as well. So when we say that there are two types, inductive type and capacitive type, remember that a capacitive type sensor is going to detect any kind of object. Whenever I want to say that any kind of object, it means that whether the surface is conductive, means metallic or non-metallic, even a paper, a water, a liquid, then wood, plastic, a non-conductive material, and even all metallic conductors, all those will be detected by the capacitive type of sensor. On the other side, the inductive type of sensor cannot detect all type of materials. Its detection limits to only the metallic type of object. So depending upon your requirement, you need to choose which type of sensor you want to go for, either inductive or the capacitive. So that totally depends upon the user's requirement. So inductive proximity sensor, as it is shown here in this figure, it will look something like this. You can see the design of the external design of the inductive proximity sensor and the capacitive proximity sensor in some cases may be perfectly same. You literally need to see the data sheet to know whether it is an inductive type or a capacitive type. So inductive sensor is an electronic proximity sensor, not only inductive, but a capacitive is also electronic type of. Electronic type of means it has some electronic circuitry in this circular tank is there. So this tank consists some processing of your the signal detection. It generates some kind of field around this, and then there is a mechanism which measures the change in that field. Okay, so inductive sensors are going to detect the metallic objects. A condition is that we should not touch them. So at some distance, so what is that distance where it will be identified? That distance is nothing but 5 mm to 1 inch. So 5 mm to less than 1 inch, within this proximity, the inductive sensor can detect the metal. The metal sensing is limited to this range. So inductive proximity sensor provides the given solution when your requirement is in this range. You need to see particularly whether your requirement is going to satisfy this criteria or not. Moving further, it looks something like this. It comes into a metallic can. On the top side, it is having the insulating material, and it is a wire, a long wire is there for the connection. So if you see this plastic part, this is called as an active face, okay? And this body is called as a proximity switch, because it is entirely going to decide whether the object came into the its proximity or not. And some target is shown over there at whose thickness is 1 mm. Indirectly, it can detect the object of any thickness. You can say 1 mm in practical sense makes a practical use makes some sense. Moving ahead, so this is what I'm going to show you the construction. If you look into the construction, that metallic tube part is going to have the oscillator. It generates an AC signal. Second, it is having the current sensor, which senses the change in the current. It is given with a positive DC supply, and this signal is given, this output is given to decide. Means it is generally connected to your what we can say, a relay. So NO or NC, whatever the requirement is, that like that you are going to give the connection. And this is nothing but a coil. This coil is going to generate the changing magnetic field. And this is a range where the active surface will be there, and this is a range. Within that range, a magnetic field is generated to sense the metal object. So how does it is going to work is like that. When a metal target enters the field, in this field, when a metal target is going to enter, generally this part is going to have its own eddy current. That current is going to circulate within the target. Okay, so this causes, whenever the target is going to come on, so there is an increase in this eddy current. So that causes a loading on this oscillator. So this oscillator gets loaded. Whenever the oscillator gets loaded, there is a change in current. The current is going to drop. So as the target is going to approach, the eddy current is going to increase, increasing the load on the oscillator. And the further, it is going to decrease the amplitude of this magnetic field. The trigger circuit monitor. So here there is some trigger circuit, means this current sensor. It is going to monitor the oscillator's amplitude, and at the predetermined level, it is going to switch the output state of the sensor from its normal condition. So that is going to be changed to NO to NC. So this DC voltage will be identified with the change in the state. As a target is going to move again away from the sensor, the oscillator's amplitude is going to increase, and the predetermined level, at a predetermined level, the trigger switches the output state of the sensor to the back its normal condition. So like this it is going to work. Moving further, it has the advantages as given. Number one, it is very accurate as compared to other technologies when you particularly want to detect the metallic objects. It is having the high switching rate. High switching rate in the sense it says that, this I already explained in the properties of the sensor. When you want to change input from 0 to 1 and 1 to 0, that time you need to observe that how fast the output is going to respond. The change in input from 0 to 1 and to from 1 to 0, that is called as a switching rate, and this is having very high switching rate. It means that its internal processing delay is quite smaller. So that is an indication of your high switching rate. Further, it can work in the harsh environmental conditions. This is a big advantage. Then on other side, what are the different disadvantages? So if you see that disadvantage, as we have already seen, it can detect only the metallic target, and the operating range is 5 millimeter to just 1 inch. So that range is limited one. So if your requirement is in within this range and you are having the metallic target to be detected, then there is no problem at all. So it works fine over there. So let me tell you, when you see such kind of, here it is, an example is given, that is proximity inductive induction sensor NPN normally. So it is having the open switch, normally open switch, and the number is given specified here. So for this particular model, if you see the data sheet, you will find that the working voltage is DC voltage. It can operate from 6 volt to 36 volt. Under loaded condition, the current is 300 milliampere. This current is going to vary, remember, whenever an object is going to come in its vicinity. Its response frequency is 500 hertz. As we said, the switching rate is higher. Then it detects a range from 0 to 4 millimeter. I want to see, whatever we say that 5 millimeter to 1 inch, that is the generalized one. So there are several proximity sensors available. Some operate from 0 to 4 millimeter, some operate from 4 to 10 millimeter, some operate from millimeter to inch range. So you need to see. So we are talking about this particular model, and this model is having a range from 0 to 4 millimeter. So if you see its wire, here it is not visible, in this part the wire is given. So wire is having three colors. One is a brown, second is a black, brown all red you can say, and the third is a blue. So this brown will be given a VCC connection of 6 volt to 36 volt, and the black will be given as a trigger signal, and blue is for, there is a correction in this PPT, sorry. So it should have the, please note, there is a change in this two statement. The blue will be the trigger signal and the black will be the ground. Moving further, this is an Arduino code. So if you have that inductive proximity sensor, it is having three lines. The red will go to the VCC. Oh, there is a correction in the design as well. I would like you to please note that this red wire should go to the 5 volt and black wire is going to ground. There is no problem. By mistake, this has been connected to ground. This red line should be connected to 5 volt and black line should be connected to ground. And this trigger is going to the A0 pin. Remember, we have given the output of the sensor to the ADC. So ADC is A0 channel of the ADC. Each channel of this Arduino, you know, is of 1024 steps, that is 10 bit. So sometimes if you want to get the range between 0 to 100, then you need to map it. Okay, so it totally depends upon the user whether you want to map it in within the given range or not, or you want to go with the entire range. So let me explain the code. So here at the side by side, I have given the code for Arduino Uno. Here we are going to define two variables, both are the float type. The first variable is a metal detected, it is initialized to 0. Second is a monitoring, it is initialized to 0. You can initialize like 0.0 as well. Then as A0 channel we are using, that A0 channel, instead of calling in program as A0, as I have connected a metal detection pin over there, so I'm going to declare this as a variable metal detection. Further, this void setup executes only once in the program whenever you run it or you reset the code. So I want to see the output on the serial monitor. That's why I'm going to have this line serial.begin. 9600 is a baud rate. Further, void loop is going to execute continuously for infinite time till you turn the connection off for the Arduino. Further, this variable monitoring is going to receive a signal, that is from the metal detection. So whatever data you read on this A0 channel, that is analog, it is nothing but analog value. So you are going to use a command analog read. So whatever the signal you received on this pin, it will be stored in this variable, that is monitoring, which is having data type float. So we want to convert that. That will be converted into the resolution, and it is in a millivolt range. So we want to convert into the volt range. So it becomes multiplied by 100 divided by 1024. 1024 is a step, and 100 is nothing but to make it percentage. Okay, remember, it is not a voltage, it is to make it. So metal detected is calculated on the basis of this monitoring received value, which is divided by 1024, that is nothing but the resolution. And this 100 is to convert it into the percentage. So next line we are going to print that the 14 core metal detector test. This is a code for a particular application in an industry with a delay of 500. Further, you are going to print that the initializing the proximity sensor. Initially, it takes 500 milliseconds to turn this on. So we are using 500 millisecond delay, and we are giving by the time a message on the serial monitor that we are initializing the proximity sensor, because the magnetic field is needed to be set well around this field. So it happens in 0.5 microsecond. That's why this delay is given. Then serial print, we are going to say that detection in process, this message will be continuously there till the object is detected. After that, as this value is read over there, in order to print that value, we are going to use the command that metal is proximated, means it has been detected, and the value will be given here. And next to that, as we have multiplied by 100, we are going to write here as a percentage. So if monitoring value is greater than 200, so we are using this 250s. If the monitoring value is greater than 250, then only we will print that the metal is detected, otherwise not. So now what is this 250 is nothing but, let me go to the previous slide. This 250 is a threshold. So this threshold, you need to compare everything every time with this threshold. When this threshold is larger, this threshold will be dependent on your application. So you, by trial and error, you can change this threshold, and like this. After that, for overall this step, we are using a delay of 1000, and you can see there is no error, no code, no error in this code. So you can go with this code. Let's move ahead. Next slide. Next, we are going to concentrate on the capacitive proximity sensor. So as we have seen inductive proximity sensor, now we will restrict our discussion to capacitive proximity sensor. So as you can see here, the capacitive proximity sensor, as I already spoke in the previous one, that it is going to detect the metallic as well as the non-metallic target. So non-metallic target, it is having the paper, wood, plastic, even glass, wood, the powder and the liquid. So without any physical contact, all these non-metallic targets can be easily detected. The capacitive proximity sensor sends the target objects due to its ability that the object gets electrically charged. Now this is something you must have the concept clear with your basics that has been already covered in 11th and 12th syllabus. So you remember that though it is having non-metallic target like a wood, plastic, glass, remember all objects are having some static charges, and whenever you are not going to change the number of charges, it is electrically neutral because the same number of charges are deposited on any object. Let me recall an experiment of piece of paper. You have the comb, and when you move the comb through your ears, through your hairs, or you will be using some silicone material, or the what you can say that a fur is there, and you rub that comb on that fur or in your hair, then it gets electrically charged. So the either positive type of charges or negative type of charges gets deposited on your comb. So when you have the piece of pieces dropped on a table, that piece of papers are having the equal number of positive and negative number of charges. Now let's assume that that comb is negatively charged. So whenever you bring that comb close to your that piece of papers, negative charges deposited on that piece of papers and the negative charges on your comb is going to have the force of repulsion. So those negative charges on piece of papers will be pushed on the backside, and the empty field will be filled up by the positive charge because there is a force of attraction between positive charges and the negative charge. So this positive charge which came to the front face of your piece of papers, and the comb which is negatively charged, now they have the force of attraction, and what you see that the paper is attracted towards the comb and it is picked up by that comb. So this is what I want to say, that whether the object is a non-metallic or metallic, all are statistically neutral. So you need to see that what is an ability of the target to get electrically charged. So there may be a variation in that. The paper may be capacity of paper to get electrical charge may be less than the wood, or maybe wood may be less than the plastic. So you need to have some basic study for that, but that doesn't really matter because ultimately it is going to detect the metallic or non-metallic targets. So just you must have your concept clear. So whenever the object is non-metallic, remember, because of its ability to get electrically charged, because of the static charges, we can definitely detect the non-metallic targets. So even non-conductors can hold the charges, as I said. So it is possible to detect any object with the help of this sensor. Moving further, the capacitive proximity sensor works on the principle of capacitance. Let me recall what is the principle of capacitance. C is equal to epsilon A by D. A is in numerator, epsilon is in numerator, and D is in denominator. So suppose you are having two parallel plates and whose area is given by capital A, that is length into the width. In that case, the area is in numerator and the distance between that two plates will be D. So if you, as you can see, that C is equal to epsilon A by D, epsilon will given by epsilon 0 epsilon R. Epsilon 0 is the permittivity of the air, or you can say vacuum, and epsilon R is the permittivity of some another material reference to that air. So what happens is that many time you can fill the gap between two plates by air or by paper or by oil or by cardboard or by some another material. So that material will have some epsilon R compared to epsilon zero. It is called as a relative permittivity. So depending upon that, that's a constant. So what type of material you are using, that is always constant. So now the capacitance depends upon area and the distance between the plate. Now if you make the area constant, once the plate is designed, you are not going to change the area. It is not practically possible because it's a physical thing. So when you design a capacitor, it has a fixed area. So ultimately what is remaining is only the distance between two plates. If you again make it fixed, then the capacitance will be fixed. If the distance is not fixed and distance is going to vary, then the capacitance is also going to vary. But remember, distance is in denominator, so capacitance is inversely proportional. Whenever distance will be less, capacitance will be more. Whenever the distance will be larger, the capacitance will be smaller. So here, the amount of capacitance varies, depends upon the size and the distance of the sensing object. Okay. So now remember, this sensor is going to have the active area whose area is fixed, but the object which is going to come into its vicinity may have the smaller area which will be faced towards the active area of the sensor, or it may be larger. So ultimately it depends upon the size also. Size and the distance both are going to matter for the sensing object. So here the figure is shown. As I said, that there is some processing unit inside. So you can see over there, this is having an oscillator which is having the DC supply, and then there is a current sensor and there is an internal capacitor plate. Remember, one plate is this and the second object which will be detected, that will act like another plate, and that area will be filled by the air. So dielectric constant will be epsilon 0 epsilon R. So only epsilon R will be equal to 1 for air and epsilon 0 will be in the picture. So whatever the charges are deposited on this, we know that the same charges, same and opposite charges, same number of, what I want to say, that whatever the number of charges deposited on internal capacitor plate will have the equal number of opposite charges get deposited on the another plate. This concept is already explained to you in 11th and 12th. When you have the electrically charged ball which is placed inside the vacuum, then the inner surface of, sorry, another ball, when this electrically charged body which is charged from outside is placed inside the another electrically charged body, then the inner surface of that another electrical charged body gets charged with the opposite charges. So this phenomena is already explained over there. So by the same principle it is going to work over there. So no need to explain this in detail. So what happens is that, so here the plate inside the sensor is going to act as a one of the plate, and the target is going to act as a some another plate, and the dielectric is nothing but air. As the object is going to come close to the plates of the means come close to the inner plate of the capacitor, then the distance between them is going to decrease. As a result, the capacitance is going to increase, and when this target goes away, the distance is increases. As a result, the capacitance goes down. The detector circuit is given here. That's the job of that detector circuit, that is a current sensor, is to find out the amplitude output from the oscillator, and based on the output switching means what kind of output is going to switch over there in the DC. The capacitive sensor can detect any target whose dielectric constant is more than air. This is a very, very important point you need to remember. It can detect only those objects whose dielectric constant will be more than air, obviously, because air is the gap between them. The changes in the capacitance generated between these two poles or these two plates, that what is internal capacitor and the external capacitor, that will be detected. Okay, so it's very nice. The working principle is already you studied before, so it's easy to understand. Let's move ahead. So what are the advantages for this? You can see here, it can detect both metallic and non-metallic targets. So you don't have to bother about whether my sensor is going to detect this object or that object. Just relax. Whether it is in powder form, it is in a liquid form, or it is in another form, it will be definitely detected. It has a good stability. You understand what is the stability? We explained. I'm not going to explain it again. It has high speed of operation. It is going to give you a good resolution. The capacitive sensors are good in terms of the power uses. It means that it is going to have the consume the low power and the low cost. So these three makes it very good, or you can say all of these are important. There is no issue in that. Moving further, let's see what are the disadvantages. It is really get affected by the temperature and the humidity, so it has a large impact on the design. So you need, depending upon this, the cost is going to vary. Then whenever the dust or moisture is there in air, then definitely the epsilon value is going to change. As a result, it may give the wrong capacitive results. So it is very susceptible to the dust and the moisture and the humidity in the environment. Further, this kind of noise is, even such kind of noise is present, it is very, very sensitive to that. So you really need to have some extra processing circuit for this. Then this is it, having difficulties in design. When you want to manufacture this, it is really complicated. As it is a capacitive, we know that capacitive relation is not linear, so linearity you cannot expect from this device. And it is not accurate as compared to the inductive, because in case of inductive, doesn't depend upon any environmental conditions. So it is independent of environmental condition. That's the beauty of inductive. But the problem is again there in inductive that you cannot detect the non-metallic surfaces. So though the problem is there, you can have the algorithm to process this noise and you can get it done. Okay, moving further. Here today we are going to discuss about a soil moisture sensor, which is of capacitive type with Arduino. So this sensor is going to detect the moisture levels in the soil with the help of the change in its capacitance. So the capacitance is literally going to vary depending upon the content of water in the soil. So the capacitance is covered into the voltage. It is going to, sorry, the capacitance is converted into voltage. That is, the voltage will range from 1.2 volt to 3 volt maximum. The advantage of capacitive soil moisture sensor is that it is made up of corrosion resistance material. So though you put down it into the water, it is not going to corrode that material. So it is a corrosion free, and it is going to give the literally the long service life, around say 5 years to 10 years. So this is a typical connection design. VCC and ground is given as shown here. Now this time it is a correct design is given, and the output is given to the A0 channel, again the ADC channel, same channel. So now here we are going to use this. I have designed this code. Go through this code. We are using two constants of integer type. Its value is not going to change, that's why we declare it as a constant. Then the value for air, if you see, that is 620 for this type of moisture, and for water it is 310. So in order to get the value, that is soil moisture value, we are using one variable as a soil moisture underscore variable value. It is of data type integer and it is initialized initially to zero. Further, we are going to convert this value into the percentage. So we require one more variable, that is soil moisture percentage of data type INT, and its amplitude is again magnitude initially is zero. As we are using A0 channel of the ADC, I am going to define this pin as a soil moist pin. So this is connect, soil moisture pin is connected to A0, that's why soil moist underscore pin is equal to A, that is A0 as it is defined here. Further, as I said, the void setup executes only once. Serial.begin 9600 is a baud rate. This is for to see data on the serial monitor. Further, void loop executes infinitely. The first line is we are going to read data from that analog pin. So we are using the command, that is analog read, and the pin is soil moist pin, which is nothing but A0 channel of ADC. The received value, there is a correction, it is not negative, it should be equal to, please get it corrected. And that value will be stored, the received value will be stored in the soil moisture, so underscore value variable. So we are going to print that serial.print soil moisture is, and we are going to give the value of that. Now depending upon this value, we want to have the change. Now that you can just take these two lines and put it next to the soil moisture underscore percentage as well. But yes, that will make more sense. Just cut these two line, okay, serial.print and serial.println, and put it next to the soil moisture underscore percentage. So you are going to map, as this ADC channel is going to have the value in between 620 to 310. So this range we are going to specify, okay. And that range is going to be mapped into 0 to 100. Again, I think there should be a correction. The water value should be written earlier and the air value must be written on the other side. No, it's correct because we want to sense the water value. It's correct. So after soil moisture value, we require air value and the water value because this is to be detected at higher scale. That's why it is given weightage of 100 and the air value is given a weightage of 0. Means it will, if it will be a dry, it will be on the lower side. When it will be wet, it will be on the higher side. So we want to say that if the soil moisture percentage is more than 100, means enough water is there, then you will give an extra message that is soil moisture is 100%. And if it goes below 40%, now this is a threshold, then in that case we are going to show that the soil moisture is 0%. So 40 is decided as a threshold, so anything that is below 40 will be treated as a 0% moisture, and more than 40 is a good moisture condition for your application. So I think this has covered, up till this we have covered the inductive and the capacitive sensors. Let's move further. Now limit switch, here the figure is giving limit switch. You might have seen such kind of limit switch. So whenever, now this is a conveyor belt, and whenever you want to stop an action of that conveyor belt, you don't want that conveyor belt to go beyond this limit, then such kind of limit switch are placed over there. So there is a lever. So whenever the lever get touched to this limit switch, like this, the reveal is there. Now this is a industry application limit switch. This is a small Arduino application limit switch. So whenever you press this button, it is having normally open and normally close. I hope you can see NO and NC is written over there. This is a common pin. So whenever you close this, the circuit gets disconnected. The power supply goes off and it makes your work stop. So this is a limit switch. It is actually extension of relay. You already use a relay. Only the relay which will be operated on the basis of the spring based lever. Yes, and that is having so many applications in the industry. So it is very useful. So limit switch can detect the physical movement and of an object by direct contact. So here, remember, before going to that touch sensor, which is again a proximity type, means touch, you need to literally touch the surface, and in limit also you need to touch the surface. So proximity sensor are taken to the next level. So when something comes very close proximity, means almost touched, that we are going to detect here, okay. So it is going to detect the direct contact of that object. An example of limit switch is that the switch that detects the open position of the car door. Okay, suppose you open the car, okay, and will give the indicator on the dashboard of your car. So whenever you close the door, that light goes off. So that is what cabin light is, gets automatically activated on when the door is open, and it gets turned off whenever the door is closed. So limit switches are basically the type of sensors which detects the presence and the absence of something, some object. Means it depends literally on your application. So what you want to get detected. Okay. Moving further, please note that the normal state of the switch is the condition which is having the minimum stimulus. Minimum stimulus means you are not going to get that switch activated. That is called as a minimum stimulus. So that will be called as a normal state. The limit switch will be in its normal state when it is not in contact with anything. So in that case, the conveyor belt, let's take an example of conveyor belt, will continue to receive the supply. When the limit switch find many and when the limit switch gets pressed, the relay gets operated and the supply gets disconnected and your conveyor belt stops. So that is what it is. One application is there. So limit switches find many uses in industry, particularly in robotic control and the CNC machine control. That is, CNC stands for the computer numerical control. So limit switch designs uses a lever, as we already seen, and it is going to have the spring, and the roller tip is going there, which is going to make contact with the moving part. The screw terminals on the switch body provides the connection type NCNO. As I said, that it's like a relay. Most of the limit switches in design share a common terminal between NC and NO, but the figure which we have seen earlier was not having that common terminal in between NC and NO. It was just on the left hand side. So like this, it is given here. Okay, now this figure, as it is said in next, see here, there is correction. Here it is said that as shown in next figure, but it is not like that. So here this lever is given over there. So this is what NC, this is NO, and this is a common. So right now it is connected to normally closed. So whenever the roller tip is pressed, in that case this common gets connected to NO and it is going to break the supply. So no supply will be received and the operation will be stopped. So it is already seen in type of relay working. So let's move ahead to the next PPT. So what are the advantages? So literally there are so many advantages. Number one, it is very simple and straightforward in the design. It works well in almost all industrial settings, or whatever kind of industrial application is there. It is limit switch will be easily fit over there. It exhibits the high accuracy and repeatability. It is a mechanical based operation, so its repeatability is very high. You know that what is the repeatability? The ability of an sensor to give the same output under different input conditions for the same input voltage levels. So it is having again the low power consumption. The switch uses, as it is a coil inside, you know that it is a relay, so it is a high it can switch the high inductance loads. It can be used to switch multiple loads. You can make it to use the multiple loads as well. Very simple to install. It is very rugged and reliable. You understand now this meaning. We already seen the characteristics of the sensor earlier in the very initial PPT presentation, and it is having the heavy duty electrical contacts. Then it is also having some drawback. The drawback is that it is a mechanical switch. So as we know that anything that is mechanical is having the limit of its operation. So it is having the low speed of operation. As there are the contact sensors, means it is necessary to make the physical contact. Without physical contact, it cannot operate. And that is an advantage, you can say, as a limitation as well. The nature of their mechanical design means it is subject to the mechanical wear and tear. As we know that we are having the spring, over the longer uses the spring get loose. In same fashion, as you are going to use this mechanical lever, so as internally the spring is there, so that spring get loose or the lever may get change in the deformation in its shape. So it depends, and over a period of time you need to actually go for the replacement. I will skip this terminology for you, just go through it. If needed, we can definitely have another session for the discussion on this. Let's skip this part. So there is some terminology. I will give this like a homework. So remember, you need to go through the terminology. What are the different terminology? It is like your homework. Go through this homework. As I given the assignment and homework in the video itself, in same fashion in this video I am specifying, this is your homework. That is what the terminology you are going to study at your own, Okay, fine, next. Then interfacing is given here, as it is shown over there. This signal is going to shown as a ground, and the pin is connected to different digital lines. Now here you did not use A0 to means all analog channel. You can use any digital pin out of this 14, 0 to 13, any digital pin can be used. So it shows for particularly some application. It is a car based application which is going to decide the left, right, down and up like this. Whenever the object will be sensed, it is going to get it detected when it is going to touch. Okay, so the code is explained here. So here the code is different from this application. Instead of using four switches, only one switch is explained, one connection is explained here as a pin number 2, and that pin is internally connected to the internal input pull-up, or you can just write input, that is also okay. And this loop is going to detect whether the switch is pressed or not. If it is not pressed, it will continue the operation. If it is pressed, then it will do the specific operation. If it is not pressed, it will do the it will do nothing. So it will continue with the operation. So whenever it will go low, it will take some action. So this depends upon the user what kind of code you want to write. This is like a more general code given here. So you can expand this code at any level. Moving further, let's go to the touch sensor. If you go to the market, you will find this kind of touch sensor. It is having three terminals, VCC, ground, and the output is there. So a touch sensor is a electronic sensor. It is going to detect the physical touch. So it is also called as a tactile sensor. It's very small, simple, and low cost. It is generally designed to replace the old mechanical switches. So in case of touch sensor, when any physical medium comes in contact with the touch sensor, the internal circuit will be closed. Okay. It is going to activate whenever the sensor is going to activate whenever the physical medium comes in contact with the touch sensor. The internal circuit, now these lines are conductive layers. So whenever you put a finger over there, these lines get shorted and the current starts flowing through it. So that is what, depending upon your touch, it identifies that the circuit has been break or circuit has been make. So it depends upon its design. Here the example is given. So whenever you can make it like this, whenever you touch, the current will flow. And you can also make in opposite way, whenever you touch, the current will not flow. It depends upon the user. So its working principle is that it is sensitive to the touch and pressure. So the pressure is given by force upon the area. The area is fixed. How much force user is going to apply, it calculates pressure for that. And depending upon that, the change in pressure is identified. Okay, so it's a simple switch which works on the it's a common principle. You can make it conductive, non-conductive as well. As I said before, you can make those layer conductive. When you short, it becomes zero and the circuit is broken. When there is a contact, the same thing is explained here. I think you can go through it. What is the meaning of open switch and closed switch? Just read it out once. Further, again, the touch sensor are of two type, capacitive and the resistive type of touch sensor. Let's cover it in fast. As capacitive touch sensors, it is again going to house the two plates and the initial capacitance will be there, C0. When your user is going to touch, the touch sensor is going to happen through the finger. So finger is going to act like a conductive object and it produces the change in the capacitance value CT. So as it is given here, two plates are there and the dielectric material is there. So whenever this plate, the upper plate is nothing but the user's finger. So this is initially open. So initially it has, because of air, that is nothing is there, whatever the dielectric charges are there. So initial capacitance will be C0. But when user is going to touch, the capacitance get added in parallel. Remember, whenever the two capacitors are in parallel, the total capacitance is sum of these two, C0 and CT. So user capacitance, threshold capacitance get added into that, and that will be your final capacitance. Remember, in parallel the capacitance get added in case of capacitor. Okay. Then in case of resistive touch sensor, it is consist of two conductive layers which are separated by a very small distance or dot. The two layers are made up of the film, and the film is coated with this material. Remember this, it is the indium tin oxide, which is very very good conductor of electricity, and it is transparent. If you see, you will not be able to see its color, it will be just transparent. A constant voltage is applied across the two films, and whenever the pressure is applied with the help of the finger, then the sensor gets activated and it senses the touch, as I said before. The sensor operates when the enough pressure is applied and the top film touches the bottom film, then the two film touches each other and they create a potential drop. Remember, so when the two films are opposite from each other, having some distance, that time there is a potential in between. So whenever you touch that two films, the potential is going to become null because it gets shorted. The point of contact of two film creates a voltage divider. As we have seen the voltage divider concept, you can say that the top film will be having one resistance on top side and the second film will be having the another resistance on bottom side. So it's like a voltage divider. Okay, so the change in voltage is detected by the controller circuit and it also detects the location or the coordinates at which the voltage divider is created. So whenever you touch, that touch is going to create a voltage divider, and at what point you touched, that will give the voltage generated, and that is will be detected by the controller circuit. The coordinate of voltage divider in terms of, it should be terms, in terms of x and y axis is created as the position of touch with the pressure is applied. So this is going to give a particular connection diagram. You can see over there the touch sensor is not shown. Actually it is going to have three pins, VCC and ground. The VCC is connected to VCC 5 volt, and the ground is connected to ground, and the output is connected to any digital pin. Let me explain the code. Now the pin number 2 is made as an input, so whatever input you get, that will be given here. Without using any extra variable, directly the pin number 2 is written here. Serial.begin, you are going to have the serial communication at the baud rate of 9600. Then this loop will be executed forever. Whenever you detect something on this pin, that is digital read is equal to high, we detect that the sensor is touched. It's so easy to write the code. It is just matter of two lines and a delay of 500. Okay, so two lines here and two lines here, that's enough in both of the loop, and your code is ready to design. So that's all there. So today we have seen the proximity sensor, inductive type, capacitive type, then we have seen a limit switch. Further we have seen the touch sensor of two types. We have seen the capacitive and the resistive type. The assignment is given, homework as specified in the video. Please go through the homework. Okay, at the time of oral, definitely the questions will be asked on that. Get a material on those terminology and upload that in your assignment folder. That will be your assignment task for this lecture. So okay, have a nice day, please study at home. I want to give a message that this holiday, this period what we are getting for next 21 days is not for as a holiday. We are supposed to complete our syllabus, so that you should not have any academic loss. Okay, so let's make it successful from both side. You also study, ask the questions, so that I will come to know that you are in the flow of study. So have a nice day. See you again. Thank you so much.